reporting on the games you love by people who love to game. The MMO Reporter Network.
You're logging into your favorite game, grinding out some gear. A couple of points added to your stats, and you have a virtual beer. Max level is pretty cool, but I'll remind you here, my friend. These games are not about the goal, it's about the journey and not the end.
You're listening to MMO Reporter, brought to you by Audible.com. Get a free audiobook download at audibletrial.com/MMOReporter. And by Doghouse Systems. Choose your weapon with Doghouse Systems.
Don't forget about your ults. You need to cherish each and every little character you've got, no matter what level they're at. Don't forget about your ults.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of MMO Reporter. This is episode 252. I'm Chris, and I'm joined once again by the ever so benevolent Mr. at MMO Bill. Hello, Bill.
Benevolent. That's a
$10 word for you.
It implies a little bit of what's the word I'm looking for?
Benevolence?
No, deificiousness. Deification.
Deificity.
Deity.
Deificity.
Deificiousness.
Deificity. There you. Sure. That's it. Deificity.
Anyway, that's long and short is I'm sure that's not what you actually intended.
No. Well, but whatever. You are a gaming god, Bill. Yeah. You're a gaming god.
Oh, my goodness.
In a world. Okay, I'm done. we are not joined by Harry Hol this week. He has a deadline and unfortunately unable to join us as he is madly... I think he probably is still writing through the night. He had a big story he had to work on, so he had to stay up all night and wasn't able to get up early to get with us. But through the magic of editing, we will add him for a review a little bit later on in the show, in 5 minutes. So... let's get into things here. Bill, what have you been playing?
Well, I'm going to start off with the obvious here, because I don't want to make anyone think I forgot something or anything like that. I did not actually play any Guild Wars 2 this week.
Wait, what?
So let that just settle for a sec.
Whoa.
Can we think about that for a minute? No, I deliberately made a choice. It's not a...
Wow.
This is not me protesting anything or anything like that. I just decided that I was going to try to spread my wings, do something a little bit different. So we left Guild Wars unopened. What I did do instead is I started off actually what I started off with was a good session playing Sword Coast Legends earlier in the week, which is a game that's just been sitting there. It's been begging me to play for ages, and good. I just did the built-in campaign.
Yeah.
It's a very rough approximation of what Baldur's Gate does. It's not quite as elegant as a feel as Baldur's Gate had. I think it's probably more elegant now than Baldur's Gate was then, if you were to compare them side by side. But it felt just a little bit clunky, a little bit rough in places. But it advanced a decent story. It's advancing a decent story. It's an interesting game. The engine is fine. I haven't run into any serious bugs or anything like that. I was reading on it too, and apparently there's a lot of hate out there for Sword Coast Legends, which makes me sad because it's... I don't think it deserves that at all. At least not from what I've seen.
Single player does, but unfortunately and here's the thing. I don't think it overpromised and underdelivered. I think people overestimated what it would be able to do, and it delivered exactly what it said it was going to do, which is what people didn't listen to what it said it was going to do and expected it to be this full amazing DM module when really the DM module is incredibly limited, but they gamified it. So it's not meant to be replacing your tabletop session. It's not meant, and you had discussed maybe it'd be interesting to jump in and excuse me, do the dungeon part of a campaign in here. You could kind of do that with very mm-hmm. little storytelling and stuff like that, but as far as doing a whole campaign, it's really rough, and the DM role is very much gamified. You have items and skills and mana type things, a threat they call it, that you have that is not what people were expecting.
You're more like the master of a dungeon keeper type game. And kind of creating that, it's more like basically being a maze builder or a live maze builder for people.
Well, you don't
You're
even
not
build
telling
it as
your
you
story.
Go.
Now, to be fair, storytelling and that kind of thing, I don't think you can make a game that would do that for you well. You can't have a story in a box and deliver that to a set of players and say, okay, here you go. Yeah. This is your brilliant narrative that's going to blow your socks off.
There have been games that have done it better.
You can't
though.
Design that. Ultimately, if you're going to DM, if you're going to run a game and you want that in there, you've got to deliver it yourself.
Right.
And what this is a way to, again, have a maze, do some combat, play that way. So yes, you're right, it is limited, and maybe that's not even the best feature of the game. Maybe the best feature of the game is going to be kind of through the module add-ons and that kind of thing, that where you get other players creating the mini adventures. So the live DM tool is not the best feature, but the tool allowing you to create modules and other environments and that kind of thing, that's what's going to actually save it. In the same way that it did for Neverwinter.
It kind of sucks too.
Neverwinter Nights, excuse me.
Yeah, it kind of sucks.
Yeah, it's okay.
I have not enjoyed it in any way whatsoever, creating any sort of content. It just didn't work. It didn't do what I wanted it to do. It didn't give me that power. I find the DM mode is better if you think of it like something like Evolve, which is a completely different style of game, but is that asynchronous gameplay. Creating the stuff, you basically can just drop things into the world and then give them some context. You can't build any sort of levels in any way. No landscape. You can drop NPCs and a few little decoration things. Some people have done some okay stuff, but when I reviewed it, which was quite a while ago, the majority of the modules that players had created by far were auto grind to get to max level. Like max XP for every kill, etc., just to grind to get to the max level. And then the rest of them were loot drops. Go kill everything at max level and get great loot, which was unfortunate. But again, that was months ago at this point. Might be better now. Might be worth, if you're jumping in there, go take a look and see if the modules are any better, because you can download them mm-hmm. and play them single player.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. So anyway. Sword Coast Legends, there you go. I also played The Old Republic and restarted there. I finally found the story mode that I hadn't actually completed in my first few runs at The Old Republic, which was as the Sith Inquisitor. And that was that's been pretty fun. It was actually kind of interesting to actually come across story items that I hadn't done yet and anything like that. So that was good. I've restarted in the Old Republic so many times it's not even funny. Mm-hmm. But I still enjoy it. I'm finding that as long as I play it like a single player game, it's fine.
Yeah,
it's good, it's decent. There's nothing wrong with it. I just don't want to play it like an MMO. I actually queued up to do what regular humans would call a dungeon. I can't remember what they call it now, but
is it encounters? Anyway, what do they call it there?
No.
Flashpoints? No.
Yes, flashpoints are thing. Anyway, I queued up for it, and I was in the I was in the queue for so long that I forgot. And I happened to, the queue actually popped for me while I was in the middle of a very long story quest fight, and I lost my turn in the queue because I was in the middle of this fight.
Yeah.
So that was a little bit disappointing, and that kind of tells me how well played the lower levels are in The Old Republic, and that's, I guess, fine. The game is what now, 4 years old, 5 years old, something like that. Anyway, it was good. I'll chew through there. I'll probably run a guy up to 60 just because just to say that I did, and then I'll probably start rolling characters up at level 60 and start the newer content at some point. But yeah. I still like it. It's again, I've said it a lot of times before. It's a decent game. It doesn't blow my socks off in any way. It doesn't grab me and make me want to play all hours of all day. It doesn't have that addiction factor. But if you tease out all of the cruff and the junk that doesn't really fit very well, like the PvP, the dungeons, the big multiplayer experience of it, it's a fine game.
You know, they just made
the wrong game. They needed to make this a Knights of the Old Republic sequel,
yeah,
instead of trying to shoehorn it into an MMO.
This whole time you've been talking, I've been showing my favorite parts of the game, which is the space combat, both the Galactic Starfighter, which was okay, but really the space combat, the on-rail stuff, was pretty much my favorite part of the game. And I spent dozens of hours, and everybody else hates it. You go back and listen to the old Tor Reporter shows and they mock me about it, but I loved it.
It's such a simple, like, as a mini game, it's fine. It's the kind of game you would play on your phone.
Yeah. Oh my God, I would pay for that.
Yeah, and it would be a decent game on your phone, but it's a mini game in the MMO, and it's not enough to carry the MMO.
Absolutely.
The story stuff is fine. As a single player game, it's fine. As an MMO, I still think there's better options. Yeah. So anyway, so that was that. I also played Rocket League. I'm actually advancing a little bit. I actually had a game earlier today and I got 5 goals. My goal is to try to get a game where I get 1,000 points in the game.
Yeah.
And I came close today. I think it was at 880 points for my effort. So
good for
I was pretty pleased. Oh, that was really good, actually. I was the MVP of the game. It was, you know, nice. not to brag, but I'm bragging a little bit.
Humble brag.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the goal. But I'm still having a lot of fun. And it's almost, I feel like it's cheating a PvP fix in there for me, because I've never been a really heavy duty PvP player. Right. And this is my way of actually getting into competition and bashing people and everything like that, but still doing it in a friendly way, because it's all about a ball.
Yeah.
So anyway, awesome. that was what I did this week. Hey, Harry, what did you do this week?
Let's do mine first, and then we'll cut to Harry afterwards. I'm going to start. I watched, actually, not talking about gaming, but I watched the full season 2. I just finished it today, of Daredevil.
Oh, I haven't started it yet. Oh, careful.
I won't say anything.
Careful where you go here.
I won't say anything. All that I will say is that every time that a Marvel property comes out, I jump back into Marvel Heroes. So that's what I did. I jumped back into Marvel Heroes, and I played some Daredevil, and the fine folks over at Gazillion sent me some codes so that I could get the pack that they currently have on sale now that gives you all the Daredevil outfits from the TV show. So I ran around with those, and you know, the one at the start of the season 1 where he's all in black, the ninja, and then the actual Daredevil one a little bit later, I went in. And I actually had so much fun. I actually got him leveled up, halfway to level cap, Daredevil, and I started at level 1. I hadn't played him before. And he's a lot of fun to play. And of course, a lot of it had to do with my excitement with the TV show. And I was so excited about the TV show. And plus, I was playing it with a controller, my Xbox controller. Now, you can play Marvel Heroes with a controller. I think I've mentioned that in shows past. And the controls are, you can definitely tell that it's tacked on, because it is, right? This is not something that the game was built around having controller support. But it's okay. It's not something that I'm constantly thinking about. Oh. But anytime I had to do anything with the UI, I went right back to my mouse. Because that's what the game is built around. So that's just what I did. But the controller was a lot of fun. It made it feel a lot. It's Diablo, right? It's Diablo with Marvel Heroes. And that was a lot of fun. So I checked that out really enjoyed it and enjoyed that content. All right. And then also I jumped into Star Wars Battlefront. They have got a new update, the Outer Rim update. So I jumped in there and played some of the new maps, the new game types, and really enjoyed that as well. I'm not a super huge fan of the HUT contracts, which are basically go in and do this specific thing in the game, like get a kill streak with this particular weapon or anything like that. They feel like daily quests and stuff, but, you know, spread out a little bit. I don't love it because it forces you to play specific weapons, and I've been working with this one type of weapon for so long, trying to get this stupid challenge done, that it kills some of the fun for me. But they've got a payload style map and some more heroes versus villains map. You know, this is all stuff from around the Return of the Jedi. I haven't played as either of the new heroes, Greedo, or I won't say his name because no one will know what it is, but the co-pilot of the Millennium Falcon when it's in the Death Star in Return of the Jedi. You know, the guy with the funky face, that laugh. You know what I'm talking about. That guy.
Yep.
With Lando, right? He's Lando's co-pilot.
Yep.
So I played that, and I'm looking forward to getting in there more. I've quite enjoyed Star Wars Battlefront. And I did play The Division as well, but I'm going to save that to discuss with Harry. So we're going to cut now. I'm going to record Harry separately, and we're going to discuss that now. And here we are, through the magic of editing, with none other than Harry Hol. Hi, Harry.
Hey there. Nice. I'm very happy to be able to join you for this little segment.
Yes, because we're going to talk about The Division, and we are ready to do our review. I have played a crap ton of it. You have played a crap ton of it. Harry, what did you think?
I had a lot of fun with it. It has its flaws, but it in essence, it's a very good loot-based cover shooter. So I'm enjoying it as long as I'm playing it with friends. The solo experience is boring me to tears, but once I got into the main story missions with friends, I had a blast.
Mm-hmm. Now, the other thing, have you had much luck with the matchmaking? Talking about playing with others, have you had much luck with the matchmaking?
I've had no issues, actually. I started playing at launch, which was... I was amazed by the smoothness of this Ubisoft launch. I had no issues. I heard people on PC had some trouble. I've had a couple of error messages pop up, but that's it. And whenever I wanted to get to strangers to meet up for a mission, it just ran smoothly. So did you have any issues?
None at all. I found that this was actually the best matchmaking that I've played in any game like this. The biggest comparison, of course, is going to be Destiny. And
it's a weird comparison because I can see why people compare it to Destiny, but it is so much its own beast. And I was actually of the mind that this is the game that I thought Destiny was going to be before we all played it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, what I like about it, as far as the matchmaking, since we're at that, is it's pretty seamless. You go in, you join. While you're out in the world, you don't have to be up in... you can be running around doing missions and matchmaking. You don't have to sit in a queue in a menu, which other games will have you do. Destiny and Blade and Soul are some recent ones that we've talked about. Not only that, I found the community has been really cool. I was running around the Dark Zone the other night, which we'll talk about the Dark Zone in a minute. And I just had, you know, I was coming up to an objective and there was a couple of yellow bosses, which is a little bit harder than normal. And two other guys that were there just invited me. And we just played together for a good hour after that. And that never happens recently in other MMOs or Destiny or anything like that. It was a really, really cool experience and it was fun.
Yeah, I had nothing but good experiences teaming up with people. I didn't do that much Dark Zone, but I did a lot of missions, and I must say, I haven't figured out, maybe I'm missing something, but I haven't figured out a way of communicating with people other than the standard emotes. So actually playing with friends using the party voice chat is a lot better, and it's a lot more fun just to yell and be panicky about bosses running around and waves of enemies burning you to the ground. If you hear your friends die, it's a lot more fun.
So let's talk a little bit about sort of the basic bones of the game. You talked, it's a cover shooter. It is much more open world. And I know I'm going to make these comparisons because I think that our listeners will also find a lot of similarities between Destiny and The Division as far as their shooters, their loot-based games, their MMO-ish. I think The Division more so than Destiny. Let's talk about a little bit about the open world. It is very open world. Like, I like that you can run from one end of the part of New York you're in to the other without a loading screen if you want to.
I agree. I do think the streets, at a certain point, you're just in another bit of destroyed New York. And even though it is a very gorgeous looking game with immense attention to detail, I do find that I kind of miss going to actual different zones with a different art style.
Yes.
You have that experience once you go into the mission instances. Those are usually gorgeously designed and have their own feel. But the open world is, it's New York. It's the grid-based street system. All of a sudden, you're in Hell's Kitchen. And a friend of mine said, hey, we're in Daredevil territory.
But look out for the devil in red.
Yeah, but he wasn't there, obviously.
No.
So, but it's kind of like, oh, this neighborhood has some excellent coffee shops, I see, and this is more electronics based. Okay.
It is very similar, and I'm at the point now where I have completed all of the side missions for all of the different the safe houses that you go to. So there's different zones, and each one is a safe house, and they're quite small. This isn't compared to like an MMO zone. You can't compare it to that because they are very small. And there's side missions that, you know, you have an overarching quest to do. My favorite area was the one where your helper agent from the division was the actor. I don't know if you've done that one yet.
I don't remember. They're all kind of blurred together because I had to play a lot.
This is minor spoilers, but basically the whole time you have division agents helping you as you do the side missions, right? They talk to you through it and stuff like that. Well, he was always like, this reminds me of season 2 when I did this. And, you know, I played an agent on TV, so I'm the perfect person to help you. Bits like that. That was really fantastic. I think the characters that they built and the NPCs that they built were fairly well done. Nothing is super, like, I didn't have any emotional investment, I don't think, in any of the characters in the game, but I wasn't bored by them either.
No, I agree. And there was some nice diversity in there as well. One of the main characters that you talked to, she was both a lesbian and divorced, which is a nice bit of modern diversity to put into the story. It wasn't a big deal, which is something as a matter of fact, and I like that.
Yeah.
If people of different creeds, colors, and things and everything are just there, not to point out that they are part of this bit, but it is just part of this organic world. And and lots of characters like that just had a little bit of personality that took them from more than just the guy with the question mark above their heads.
Yeah, so I like that. Now, one of the things that I noticed not noticing was actually, and you and I think are going to notice maybe more than others, was the lack of a really outstanding soundtrack. I really don't remember any of the music from the game at all, and I've been trying to listen for the last few days since I had that sort of thought. Do you have a favorite tune from the game at all?
Well, yeah, my favorite podcasting app was running all the time.
Yeah, and that's...
You don't really... The audio is... And that's maybe why I don't really remember all the dialogues, because at a certain point when you're really deep into it, it is kind of fluff. It doesn't really add anything. You can just walk to the next marker, kill everything that's red, and there are some rewards for actually looking, because there's one thing I noticed. A friend of mine said, well, you're just actually a criminal because you're just randomly shooting people just because they light up red. But then I discovered, actually, this is true. I mean, you can't just play it like that, but those people who light up red do light up red for a reason. If you sneak up to a group of mobs, let's call it that way, and you're in cover and they haven't noticed you yet, you usually see a little play happening explaining why they are criminal. For example, they're robbing somebody or keeping them under a gunpoint or something like that, which gives you... You don't need the reason, obviously, because they're red, so they can die. But if you want to, you can actually justify for yourself why they're dead.
Yes. Yeah, I like that. And it's a very living world. It is very much a living world, and I enjoyed that as well. Now, go ahead. Yeah.
Well, there was one thing that I noticed after playing a couple of hours that I found very jarring. There are some missions where you have to free hostages.
Oh,
That's fine. I have no problem with that. Freeing hostages.
I know where you're going with this, and I totally agree.
So you first have to fight your way through a couple of waves of enemies, and all of a sudden you get a little blip on your scanner saying, here's the key. You get the key, you open the cell, you free the hostages, and then you go into their cell, and in their cell are two or three loot boxes with huge big guns.
Yeah.
Why did they lock the hostages with heavy machine weapons? Why?
Yeah. yeah, exactly. I totally agree with you on that. That's absolutely ridiculous. Especially with the, you know, as part of the cover shooter, there is some, like, some of your cover that you go to is semi-destructible to the point where you might get shot through it. So you, they probably could have shot their way out the door. Like, seriously.
Or
killed their hostage takers.
If a friend of mine said, well, maybe there weren't any bullets. Well, you can just hit them.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like it's beyond the realms of possibility to fight. Anyway, never mind. It's these little things that where game mechanics, and this is something has to do with the realism level. Because if you're walking around New York, it looks gorgeous and lots of details, even little pamphlets on the walls looking for people or pets or whatever. And there's so much that grounds you in a present day version of an post-apocalyptic New York.
Mm-hmm.
But
I am looking forward to going to New York. I'm going in about a month, and I'll be there.
I hate you because I've never been there. This is on my bucket list. I have to see New York, damn it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, you played The Division.
Well, yeah. I'll try. If I get there, I'll try not to put into practice what I learned in The Division.
Yes.
But one of the things that I noticed when you're battling enemies, and this is something I do find a major flaw, the enemies you battle are pumped up by stats to be tougher. And that means that you can unload several clips of an AK-47 into the head of a criminal who's wielding a baseball bat, and he still won't go down.
Yeah.
And if you're playing a game like Destiny with fantasy creatures, that's not a jarring experience. That's just something you accept. But because everything else looks so gritty and realistic, this is really annoying. And then you get to the boss designs, which are, I think, the weakest part of the game. Don't you agree?
Bullet sponges.
Yeah, it's bullet SpongeBob all the time. Nothing really interesting. You just have this slightly bigger guy with a lot of armor plating. There is some design there, but you don't see that design because you're usually behind cover,
right,
just looking for the mark that's wandering through 3D space, trying to unload clips on them, and they are just not interesting encounters.
And there's no, excuse me, at least I haven't run into it yet, there's no sort of strategy to attacking a boss other than go hide and die. There's no mechanics to a boss other than they're going to shoot you. And it's how they shoot you that might be the mechanic. But there's no big thing. Like, even in Destiny, there's a lot more mechanics to the bosses. They're varied. They're different. They have different abilities. Whereas this one, it's either different types of guns or flamethrowers, or that's pretty much it. Maybe some grenades or turrets.
There is an aggro mechanic, and and that's where the playing with friends comes into play.
Right.
Where one guy just puts down a turret and takes aim at the enemy, and other people can flank them, and that makes for a very interesting and tactical feeling because you're going from cover to cover. You're using your special skills, which is something we have to get into, the skill system, by the way. But then you get an actual tactical Tom Clancy-like experience, and then the name kind of makes sense rather than just covers. And so there are tactics to bringing down bosses, and there are things to take into account, but it's not, as you say, it's not like a boss in three phases with a weak spot or with...
Right.
There are no vehicle battles. There's one helicopter thing, but there could have been so much more creativity in that.
Yeah, and that's the thing is, yes, there's tactics, but the tactics don't change based on the boss. As a group,
exactly,
you're going to go in and have the exact same tactics on a boss for this mission as you are for a boss for this other mission.
Yeah.
And that is not as pleasant as some other games. Let's move on to character progression, because I think there is some MMO nature in the progression of characters in The Division, and I don't mind it too much. Why don't you start talking about that a little bit?
Well, the main progression is in building out your base. And I think that's a very interesting choice they made. So you have this open world, and there is one main there are several safe houses where you can meet other players, but you have one base of operations that is uniquely your own. It's kind of like the Normandy in Mass Effect. It kind of felt like that. And it's just your location and with three different wings, medical, tech, and security. And those three wings have different missions for building it out, for getting resources to expand those wings. And by expanding those wings, you'll unlock new abilities in your tech tree. And that allows you to refine how you want to play the game. Do you want to be a full healer? Do you want to be a tank? Do you want to be a support character? And that is the main progression from level one to max level. I like, by the way, that if you unlock abilities and you slot them, you can respec at any time, even during battle. So there is nothing locking you into a choice. You can just go on the fly. And by getting more skills, you can slot two of those skills, later three, in your R1 and R2 buttons, which is very much like Mass Effect, where you have a couple of special skills that you can use on top of the regular gunplay, and that really changes the way you play your game.
Now, what did you think of the UI?
It was an acquired taste. I do think they did a lot of things very well. I like the way everything was in the middle of the screen. So there is this kind of hologrammatic interface floating around your character. And if you open up your map screen, a hologram is projected all around you. It looks cool and is actually quite functional. I didn't have to wrestle a little bit with the inventory screens to find out why there was something new. And if you forget to look at a new skill, then you'll keep having one of those markers like, there's something new, there's something new. But, you know, you just don't know why or what. So there is something that could be refined. But basically, I was kind of okay with it.
Now, also the crafting system. There is a, I'd call it, rudimentary crafting system in the game. What did you think of it?
Well, the clever thing to do when you get weapons and equipment that you don't need is you grind them to a pulp and you get some basic materials, very basic. You have basically just pieces of fabric from your clothing that have different colors, and different colors can be can yield different types of better loot. But that's basically it, and it's kind of like Diablo, but it's not more than that. It does yield the better equipment, so it's better to do that than sell them and buy new equipment. But it's still not very. I really like the modular design of the weapons. By the way,
yes.
The fact that you can because once you got a weapon, it's not just done. You can put an iron sight on it, or you can change the magazines, or you can change the handle for more stability. And it's I found it very satisfying to kind of build up your weapon and slotting new stuff into it.
Agreed. And very much like a MMOs, that the same weapon will have different stats on it or something like that. I found that it was... I mean, you really, there's only a few different types of weapons, and you got to it, and that started to get a little tired, but then I found the ones that I loved, and I was happy. Took me a while to get. I wanted to have sort of a semi-automatic and then a sniper rifle. It took me till level 12 or 13 before I was able to get a sniper rifle to do sort of the range stuff. I was quite surprised that it took that long.
Yeah, I had the same thing, but I was quite happy with some of the other rifles. And once I found some of my favorites, I could get along with the weapon choice. The weapons feel good. They shoot well. They have a nice punch to them, except that, well, bullet sponges. But they are a tad boring if you come from a fantasy setting or a science fiction setting, because you're just basically firing bullets.
Yeah. Appearance system. We're talking about inventory and all that sort of stuff. They got a fully fledged appearance system with six different slots that you can change stuff up. I was happy that they had that right at the very, very beginning with some other games. I'm quite frustrated that, especially shooter MMO type games where you're stuck with a certain look, and appearance items drop as loot. throughout the game. I was really happy with that. I found it was somewhat limited, and it was sometimes disappointing when you finish a big mission and, hey, look, you got this big fancy new beanie. And that was sometimes a bit of a letdown, but I found that there was enough drops that were worthwhile that I wasn't feeling that when I got appearance drops.
Yeah. And I do like the appearance system, but it's, you're never going to look really different from your general character. There is nothing,
right.
There are no capes. There's nothing that makes you flamboyant or really, there are no trench coats or stuff that make you badass. And everybody seems to be walking around with their jacket unbuttoned, which is interesting because it's cold out there. Yeah.
And you do look very similar to everybody else. It's a good thing that the names are nice and bright on the screen, or else I wouldn't be able to tell anybody apart in my group. That's the one thing. It's different shades of earth tones that you've got, and some gray, some browns. You know, you're not going to get a hot pink jacket here. This is going to be, you know, I've got a gray, I've got a brown, I've got a dark green. It's all very military-ish, which it fits the style, but also is somewhat limiting in how different you can look, like you were saying.
Yeah, but I don't really mind because I've never been one for... that's not true. If I really get invested in an MMO, I do like to have some cosmetic options. But I don't really care that much. I do know there are people who find it a game breaker, a deal breaker, if something doesn't allow them to look awesome.
I like me some armor sets. I love armor sets when I'm playing MMOs. WoW, Rift, WildStar. I love those armor sets. So there's not really much of that in this particular game. So, Harry, what type of players are going to want to play this game? Who can we recommend this to?
If you have a couple of friends and you really enjoy some tactical shooting, then you could do very much worse than The Division. It has a lot of MMO-like things there, but I do think I would recommend it to people who want to play with their friends, because I think playing with strangers... It doesn't have the legs that a general MMO would have, where you would have a community where you would befriend people and have friends list with actual communication. It's not really there. So it's a very social game. Play with your friends. Take it through the story for 40 hours. And after that, I think you'll get your money's worth even if it ends there. Endgame right now isn't that interesting yet, but I don't think that makes it a lesser experience.
Right. And the end game is mostly Dark Zone, which is think of it as a world PvP area where if you die, you actually lose XP, think old world EQ, and drop all of the items. You've got a different inventory for the Dark Zone that you have to extract. I had a lot of fun last night, so I think I'm a little biased in my thoughts on the Dark Zone because I had such a good experience last night. I went all the way up to Dark Zone level 12, all sort of in one big chunk, and it went really, really well. I had a lot of fun, grouped with random people, and really had a great time. So that's the majority of the end game. You can redo all the missions on harder modes and continue to do them, increasing the difficulty to get better loot.
And the great thing about the Dark Zone is that you can actually even kill people in your own party.
Right.
Which reminds me, we must really play this game. But aside from that, not that I would ever shoot anybody that I know, obviously. That's not my style. But
you totally shoot me.
Yeah. In a second, in a heartbeat. The moment you turn around, boom.
The last thing I want to mention before we end things here is I've been fairly impressed with the responsiveness of the dev team to the community. They made a big change to the Dark Zone in the currency drops that you had for going into the Dark Zone. It was an absolute bomb, and I think a week later they changed it back, which gives me some positive thoughts towards the future about this game, whereas if they're responsive to their mistakes... Optimism, thank you. if they're this responsive to mistakes that they make in development, because they've got to try stuff. They've got to keep balancing and changing stuff and making things better. And if they're this responsive, I think this is a good sign for the community as a whole.
Yeah, and these are things they can only balance in a live game.
Yeah.
Because there is no way to anticipate. Yeah. At a certain point, people were actually not going rogue, not killing other players anymore in the Dark Zone
right.
because the punishment was so high. Because you lost a lot of money and you lost a lot of experience points, could go down levels. So people were actually actively avoiding combat with each other, which was not the design they went for, obviously. So they're tweaking and they're changing, and I have high hopes that they will keep on doing
it. It is an absolutely fantastic and fun feeling to be running around the Dark Zone and constantly having to look over your shoulder to see if there's other players there who are going to kill you as you kill sort of PvE mobs as well. So really fun part of that as well. All right, Harry, I think that's our discussion for The Division. I think we've given our listeners a good idea of whether or not they might like this game and they can make their own decisions. We'd love to hear about people's experience in the game, whether they agree with us or disagree with us. You can just send us an email and or a tweet or anything like that. We'll have all the information at the end of the show. Before we move on to the news, let's really quickly talk about our patrons, my favorite people in the whole wide world. If you want to support the podcast, go to patreon.com/MMOReporter, and you can help us keep the metaphorical lights on, which at this point actually means bandwidth, getting us bandwidth to get all the shows out, because bandwidth is expensive. So help us out. Go to patreon.com/MMOReporter. Before we move on to the news, Harry, you have got a special thank you to send out there.
Absolutely, yeah. I would really like to send a personal thank you to Rebecca, who supported us on the Patreon campaign. Thank you so much for your support. I really appreciate that. So thank you. Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you.
And now we'll move on to the news. Instead, then you couldn't stop the wipe just by saying, oh, pew, pew. La di da di da da da. More than deems. La di da la di da.
So there was a bit of drama brewing in the gaming world this week, all centered around the what's apparently a key person over at Wildcard Games, which is the developer of Ark. And of course, Ark has been big. It's had a good year and it seems to have had a really solid launch on Steam. There's a lot of controversy right now going around the involvement of the former CTO and creative designer over at Trendy Development by the name of Jeremy Stieglitz. So basically, Stieglitz is being accused of breaking a no-compete clause and a non-solicitation clause when he left Trendy, and Trendy is accusing him of violating that non-compete by being a key player in the development and the building of Wildcard. As well as coming after Trendy developers and trying to lure them over to Wildcard and a couple other things and that kind of thing. Anyway, it's a big, dramatic lawsuit that's basically calling into question the legitimacy of the development of Ark. Stieglitz has been accused as being in there, but one of the rationale that's mentioned in the article, this is all on a Kotaku article that we're pulling this information from. Apparently Stieglitz's wife is on a bunch of key documents around the founding of Wildcard and a bunch of the key development decisions and that kind of thing, and they're assuming that Jeremy is using her as a proxy and at some way for working through Wildcard. They're accusing him of having approached Trendy developers, and apparently they've got some evidence to that accord. This is a lawsuit that was initially filed in December, but it's really starting to heat up now. One of the reasons why it's starting to heat up is one of the Wildcard co-founders, a fellow by the name of Jesse Rapchak, did an interview over at GDC last week that said that Stieglitz had consulted on ARK, which he really wasn't supposed to do. The terms of his exit from Trendy, which was in 2014, was that he had initially he'd had a non-compete clause enforced on his contract that was actually there when he signed his initial contract with Trendy. So this isn't a, something that he agreed to after he was let go or after he left Trendy. This is something that was apparently part of his contract when he was first hired. That was initially a 3-year non-compete after he left, and he negotiated that down to 1 year, which would have ended in August of 2015. But they're accusing him of having done work for Wildcard before August of 2015. So all kinds of drama and everything like that. It's filthy and dirty and messy and everything like that. But you know what? This is a dirty, dirty, slow week for news. So this is what you get. What do you think, Chris? What's jumping out at you from this this schmozzle?
Well, this is a really tough one because I know we talked about in the pre-show about the non-compete clause and the fact that he signed it at the time of beginning employment rather than at the time of it was part of the initial hiring contract. And you had a bit of an issue with that, right?
Well, I do. I mean, it's my issue is that it's complete and utter bullshit. I don't care if you're a game developer or if you're an IT professional or if you're anything. It doesn't even matter. Like any profession, period. A non-compete clause in your contract when you are first hired, especially one that's for 3 years, should be a gigantic red flag to run screaming away from that. And it really shouldn't even be enforceable. 3 years of being unable to work in your chosen field is essentially career suicide for a lot of people. So it essentially either becomes a you work for us and only for us forever contract, which is not legal, or it's a it's just a completely unenforceable clause that's a waste of paper anyway and only good for creating news stories on Kotaku when you inevitably try to continue your career somewhere else after your relationship is broken down with your previous company.
But he did sign it, right?
He signed it and
okay.
Yes, he signed it. It's in general, I'm not even going to talk about whether Jeremy Stieglitz signed it with Trendy or this particular situation. Non-competes in general are stupid and they should be ignored in general all the time as being I don't know if it's fair to call it a violation of some kind of right. I don't know your ability to reassociate or to work or that kind of thing. It feels like it's impinging your ability to actually pursue a career in a really unfair way.
Right.
And potentially levering somebody who's desperate for employment in a way that maybe when they're not so desperate later along the line, it's unfair leverage to put on someone. So it's kind of like saying to that guy in the corner who's asking for a dollar, says, okay, here's that dollar, but you're not allowed to accept any dollars from anyone else forever.
And I have to admit, I am completely at odds with myself on this because number one, he did sign it. But number two, when you're looking for work and you really want to work for this developer, that will that will definitely cloud your judgment on what you're looking at as far as clauses go. And that's not, not a very fair is the wrong word. It's not a very good business way to do things. It's not a very upstanding way. Moral was the word I was looking for, but that doesn't fit right. But you know what I'm getting at. It's kind of a crappy thing to do to put that in the contract.
It makes me think that the employer has no faith that they could actually keep their employees legitimately by offering them challenges and fair compensation.
Right.
That they have to resort to weird legal clauses that are essentially compelling people to work for them because they have no other choice.
Yeah.
No. So that's the thought on non-compete clauses. I'm sure there's places for it that I'm not thinking of right now, but I think they're junky. That said, from the sounds of it, I mean, it's really hard to kind of make up the fact soliciting employees. So I mean, I doubt that it's really possible for for Trendy to have invented the fact that Stieglitz may have reached out to some of their developers and that kind of thing. That's not the kind of thing that you can just kind of say, oh, he totally tried to hire me away without like some kind of email train or some kind of evidence to say that that impropriety occurred. So that's a little bit damning. Clearly Ark has been in progress and in development, and that and Wildcard has been around since prior to August 2015. So Stieglitz would have, if Stieglitz is a key player with Wildcard now, it's likely that he was probably there in the formative times that he wasn't supposed to be. So technically he might be breaking those clauses. It kind of sounds like there's, I'm not really a fan of either side in this case.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe as more details come out, it becomes a little bit more clear, but it's a gross development. And of course the fallout is that it may have impact on Ark, because Ark is a young game. It's growing quickly. It's really done very well, much better than I think anybody ever expected it to do, other than maybe the folks at Wildcard. A lawsuit like this could really be kind of a chilling effect on that game.
Yeah, a couple things. One, their Jesse Rapsack is actually college buddies with Jeremy Stieglitz, if I'm pronouncing that right. So they're longtime friends for this. Secondly, didn't the courts recently say it was illegal for Apple and Microsoft and Google and all them who had those no poaching agreements? Didn't they say that was illegal? So the whole talking to employees, maybe it was during the non-compete clause that they're talking about and stuff like that. But overall, everybody's kind of being poopy, and I think it's going to come down to the legality of the clauses in the original hiring contract, because it really does sound like there's no really way around it. I do think that it sounds like he did contribute in some way. And even then, even if his wife is not acting as a proxy for him on all the paperwork and all that sort of stuff, I mean, could you imagine purposefully, like totally and utterly not talking to your wife about what her day was like and what work was like? And if that's your field of work, like, how could you not just say, oh, have you tried this? You know, comes home very frustrated and stuff. Oh, that'd be hard to do, because that's just married life.
And if that's the case, then clearly this is a frivolous lawsuit. But I don't know, what's Susan Stieglitz's history in gaming? If she's never actually developed a game, or never been an executive or never done business before, then or never been in the gaming business, then that's a little bit that's a little bit suspicious that all of a sudden she's a co-founder of a game development studio.
Yeah. There's a lot of Susan Stieglitz on LinkedIn. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. So there we go here. I'm just looking to see the history, right? There's not much in here as far as gaming goes beforehand. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to go into detail, because that's someone's life. But needless to say, there's only two, and the only real big one in gaming is Wildcard. So that makes things even more interesting, Bill.
Anyway, we'll see what happens. But this is just gross and sketchy, and I hope I never hear about it again. Sorry, everybody.
All right, let's move things along. Quick mention here before we get to our sponsors. The Orcs Must Die open beta starts March 29th. I have played Orcs Must Die a few times, I have enjoyed my experiences in the game. It's definitely, I mean, I was playing it in alpha, so it's a lot different, I'm sure, than it is now. It is a free-to-play game where you buy gold to then buy cards, which will get you minions and traps and heroes and stuff like that. It's very much like a MOBA had a baby with Orcs Must Die. It really is. It takes the MOBA mechanics of the heroes, which ArcsBest I already kind of had, adds the traps, adds the lanes, that sort of stuff, and puts out a pretty fun game. I know I was talking to Patrick over at Lorehound. We did a stream of Gigantic. And he was saying that it feels very MOBA-ish when he goes into Orcs Must Die Unchained. They play it semi-regularly. So are you going to jump in?
Just a comment. I really enjoyed Orcs Must Die 1 and Orcs Must Die 2. I haven't really got into Orcs Must Die Unchained. I think it's adding a lot of complexity to a game that I really enjoyed for its simplicity before. Mm-hmm. Like, there was just something nice about setting up vicious traps for hordes of orcs and then blowing them to pieces as fast and as well as you can. That's fun. Getting into the whole earn cards, buy gold, upgrade your upgrades so that you can upgrade the upgrade. It just sounds gross.
Yeah. Well, you know, but then you can upgrade your upgrades of your upgrades that you upgrade.
Oh, so you're saying that if you upgrade the upgrade, then right. Then your upgrade will finally be able to be upgraded to the final upgrade.
Right. Correct.
Okay.
You got
Why
it.
Didn't I? I should have thought about it that way.
I mean, I didn't think I had to mention it. I thought it was pretty obvious.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Let's move on to our sponsors. Talk about our first sponsor, Audible. Audiblepodcast.com/MMOReporter for all of your audiobook needs. This is a fantastic company that puts out some fantastic audiobooks. If you like to listen to your books, maybe you've got a commute, something like that, you can go and check that out. It's a lot of fun to listen to an audiobook. I know I've got a long commute, so I often will listen to an audiobook on my way into work. They've got some great readers as well. This is Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, otherwise known as the Philosopher's Stone for other people, narrated by Jim Dale.
The Boy Who Lived. Mr. and Mrs. Dursley of Number 4 Privet Drive were proud to say they were perfectly normal, thank you very much. They were the last people you'd expect to be involved in anything strange or mis...
So pretty cool stuff. You can check that out, audiblepodcast.com/MMOReporter, and you can help support the network that way, or going over to doghousesystems.com, using the coupon code MMOReporter when you buy your new system, and you add a free 120-gig SSD to your computer for absolutely nothing. That's why it's free. Doghouse Systems is the premier boutique PC maker in the world, so go check them out, doghousesystems.com.
Troll for a wagon in skirmish runs. Pull that boss when your healer yells out of mana. Pull that world boss out of party. Run through trash, you'll be sorry.
All right, so we've been mentioning over on LOTRO Reporter about some of the issues that Turbine has been having with LOTRO and the server switch that they made. They changed over to a different host, for lack of a better term. They changed their server location, and that's caused a lot of problems for LOTRO, but I think DDO has been getting hit pretty bad with the lag issues. Now, we had a user over on Facebook. Now, I forgot to ask permission to mention his name, so I'm not going to do that, but it was a mention over on our Facebook page that asked us to look into it. So I emailed Turbine and Jerry Snook, our friend of the show. He's been on this show before, in fact. LOTRO Reporter as well. Did reply. He's their one of their community guys now. He did reply and let me know. I asked him a few questions. First, I said, what's currently being done to try and resolve these issues? And the official reply was, we are implementing new network connections and adjusting our main networking backbone. Additionally, we are troubleshooting server-side configuration changes. Now, let me go through all these, Bill, and we'll chat about it in a second. So I also asked him, what about these particular issues is making them so hard to solve? Because this was a while ago they made the server change. As part of our move to the new data center, we updated some architecture to modern operating systems and virtualization technologies. In some cases, adjusting the old code to run in this new environment has added additional challenges. And then I finally asked them, what can players expect in the near future as fixes to the lag issues? They said they're migrating selected networking components and making additional configuration changes to the servers. So before I let you talk, Bill, I just want, because I've been thinking about this since it was sent and the answers that they sent. and whether or not I was happy with the answers. And I think in the end, I am. DDO is a very, very old game in the grand scheme of things. It is a senior citizen as far as games go. And I know that for ourselves, we were looking at migrating hosts for our server, for our hosting, our WordPress install to a newer one, and it was going to cause a ton of issues. And that's only a WordPress site. That's not a very big deal. So something like DDO, which has millions of lines of codes, I can't even imagine the issues that running to new server infrastructure would cause. And I absolutely believe them that they're doing everything that they can. And I know it sucks for DDO players, and I do think that Turbine is doing everything that they can, but it's just part of having an older game. They had to migrate to the new data center. There's going to be some issues. And I know this is, you know, sometimes some of the stuff that you deal with as you have some IT components to your work. So I can imagine you've dealt with issues similar to this and understand fully what Turbine is going through.
Yeah, like, and that when I, a few components of my work is basically all of them. I'm an IT pro, so not to say that I know exactly what they're going through here or anything like that, but I can tell you that the kind of migration that they're talking about is very hard and very complicated. And if it had gone perfectly, I would have been stunned to the floor. Like, there's, when you're talking about like core infrastructure changes, when you're talking about modernizing of operating systems and that kind of thing, it's hard. There's always something. And, you know, the longer you go without doing it, the harder and harder it becomes. So I have all sympathy for these guys. I understand it's really frustrating for players, and it absolutely should be. It's annoying, but I guarantee that the guys who are in charge of the infrastructure and the technology pieces here that are not going well, they're having a hell of a time, and they're having a much worse time than anybody who's concerned about lag right now. I promise.
And again, just to try and make it a little bit newer, not newer, a little bit more, you know, connected to sort of a reality that some of our listeners might understand, because it's hard to think of the virtual idea of the program on servers and all that sort of stuff. I'm sure that some players might say, well, why didn't they just leave it where it was? And again, bringing it into us, looking at changing to the newer hosting service cut our costs in half, not just, you know, a little bit, literally in, it would have been half. I could have gotten 2 years for the price of 1 year of our old hosting, because the newer technology is easier and it's more work for our hosting provider to maintain the old environment that the site currently runs on. So this was something that had to be done for the game. I'm sure it had to be done for the game. They couldn't just have left it on the old servers.
No, well, because you could talk about performance or technology improvements and everything, but I mean, it gets down to the core stuff that everybody cares about, but nobody really understands, like security and that kind of thing. If you're running on outdated operating systems, or if you're running on ancient hardware that can only take advantage of protocols up to a certain point, it becomes a security issue. And for a game that handles your credit cards and handles transactions and everything like that, you don't want them running on old Windows XP level technology out there. I'm not accusing them of running their servers on Windows XP, of course. But I mean, if you're that far out of date, you're just inviting somebody to come and poke a hole in there eventually, and oops, there's all your credit cards. Done. So no, I mean, you have to, your technology has to grow as technology grows. It's always a race, and you can never stand still. That's just the science of information technology. There's no way around that. You can't have a 20-year infrastructure. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah. Yeah. No. So, you know, unfortunately, I don't think this is the news that our listeners wanted or DDO players wanted, but this is just going to be a really ugly time that in the end will add to the longevity of the game. Mm-hmm. The other option probably that I wouldn't be surprised if they considered it was, okay, do we do the server, the data center move? Do we bother, or do we shutter DDO?
Well, that's the other thing that's actually a bit of a scary thought, is there comes to be a point where you have to actually look at yourself and say, okay, now we have to make this decision. Our technology is really old. It's going to cost this much to modernize it. It's going to be this risky to stay at the old technology. At what point does the needle tip towards shutting everything down? That's a bit of a scary thought, and I don't think anybody in the DDO universe wants that. So it might be painful right now, but if you're a DDO fan and you want to be playing DDO 5 years from now, this is probably pain you kind of have to just endure.
Yeah, and I know for me, DDO has a special place in my heart. It's where our group really got into gaming and gaming together. On a fairly regular basis. There was a while there where we were playing DDO 7 nights a week. Yeah.
You're not wrong. It's just it's an amazing thought to have right now.
All of us, right? We would get home we'd get home. Kids would go to bed. I remember Selenia got up and played DDO the morning of when our youngest was born, when we were going into the hospital. She got up, she couldn't sleep anymore. She got up and went on the computer, played DDO for a while, and then I got up and went to the hospital. Away we went.
There you go.
So I really don't want to see it go.
No.
All right, on to our quick mentions. Another Warhammer game has bit the bust. Warhammer 40K Dark Nexus Arena is going to be shuttering. It's a MOBA. And it never quite came out of beta, and it's going away.
It's a curious thing. Like, there's been so many Warhammer games that seem to really struggle. Like, the Total War series did okay, but...
Well, that wasn't all Warhammer. They're just doing a Total War Warhammer.
No, I know, but I'm talking about just the IP seems to be... I mean, you don't want to talk about toxic IPs because obviously Warhammer is kind of it's an interesting IP. It's certainly an interesting pen and paper IP.
Yeah.
But it's also, it's a bit of a poison when it comes to anything other than the Total War games.
You know what? I actually really, really enjoyed and played it a couple of times through Warhammer Space Marine.
Yeah.
And I played that game quite a bit, and it was a fun shoot. It was just a shooter, though. It was nothing fancy, but it was a really good shooter. And I think Dark Crusade was the expansion pack for it, or like sort of the sequel to it. It was a really, really great Space Marine game. Like, it felt right. It worked right. The Space Marines had weight, so I really enjoyed that. Other than that, though, Warhammer Online didn't go. Warhammer Online Arena, or whatever it was called, never took off. It also never exited beta.
And where it comes from is I'm kind of monitoring Eternal Crusade to see if it's going to be good. And I want it to be good, and I don't want it to have the same fate as Dark Nexus. So
yeah,
anyway, we'll see what happens. So anyway, if you're a Dark Nexus player, then you might want to find another game to play.
Do they give a date? March 31st. You have got hours. You can count it in hours now, ladies and gentlemen. Hey, Bill.
Hey, Chris.
Have you ever experienced the wonder that is Green Flame?
I have, several times actually. In fact, while you were there. Oh, sorry. Green Flame.
Thank you.
I feel like that needs a sound drop instead. Somebody should do that in post.
Yeah. So they're adding the Chris Perkins hosted Portobello's campaign, or what is it? Portobello's campaign. Yeah. Which is basically a mini role-playing session in Dungeons and Dragons in Neverwinter. And it's fantastic. You have to listen. I'm going to play a little bit of the sound bite here. Here comes.
Green Flame!
There it was. So for those of you that don't know, this is from the Acquisitions Inc. long-running D&D campaign that's been happening at PAX and PAX East for many, many years. This is a PAX and PAX East only adventure. I haven't heard of this happening at PAX South or PAX Oz. And it's something that we go out of our way to attend every single year. Mm-hmm. And it is amazing. They fill Benaroya Hall with people watching other people roleplay. And it's amazing. Mm-hmm. If you haven't had a chance, check out the YouTube videos of Acquisitions Inc. They're all on there, and you should go check them out. We'll throw a link to those in the show notes as well. Bill, we're going to play the crap out of this, aren't we?
This sounds neat, yeah. I mean, it is essentially a mini game, so you could only, I mean, try to temper your expectations, obviously, but this looks really cool.
Uh-huh. I'm excited. Bill, I'm a little excited.
I heard.
Yeah. All right. Next quick mention here. If you have been playing Elite Dangerous and you have been using Voice Attack, which is a voice control software for your PC to control Elite Dangerous, we have got a new voice coming for you. Let's see if you can figure it out here just by me playing the sound clip. Ready?
Ready for departure.
Acknowledged. Pre-launch diagnostic checks. All systems ready to go.
Isn't
final checks
great?
To ascent thrust vector controls complete. Stand by for launch.
So if you couldn't tell, that is none other than the one, the only William Shatner, who will soon have a voice pack. Actually, it's available now. I thought it was going to be available in a little bit. It is available for Elite Dangerous, and you can now have William Shatner be your computer, a.k.a. Orion. And they kind of use the Masters of Orion font a little bit in that. A little bit. Yeah.
A bit of a stretch, but this is so cool. Like, this is the dream in Elite Dangerous, is to be able to talk and then have your ship talk back to you in William Shatner's voice. This is a really neat idea. So it's not even just your regular ship communication or your confirmation commands and that kind of thing. There's actually a built-in, it's almost kind of like a tour. A guided tour, like William Shatner will guide you through some key or interesting nebulae and systems and that kind of thing, to kind of basically give you a map to explore. I don't think it's a huge tour or anything like that, but you get William Shatner's voice speaking, or Orion speaking to you, telling you about the various systems and a little bit of history made up and that kind of thing. It's a really neat idea to sell the voice pack is obviously on its own very cool, to be able to just have William Shatner's voice on there. But to actually have that kind of guided tour and give you something to do in a super free-form game like Elite Dangerous, this is a neat idea. So this really caught my eye. I loved this story. This was so cool.
Now, the last time I have used voice control software is a little title from a long time ago that I played the crap out of called Bridge Commander.
Yeah.
And I got some voice, and it may have been like a crack of software. I'm sorry, I'm a horrible person. And I got some voice control software on my computer, and I could sit in that captain's chair and I could control my ship. And it was amazing. And I'm showing the graphics now. And it's horrible, like Half-Life level graphics, right? Like horrible graphics. But I'm a sucker for space stuff. And just like I love the Star Trek Online space battles, where a lot of people think they suck, I absolutely love them. And so, yeah, I was often in that game. Yeah. Anyways, moving things on, I don't think we need to watch more Bridge Commander, although I did save that trailer so I can, that YouTube video, so I can go back to it. I gotta find, maybe Good Old Games has Bridge Commander. Ooh, I'll have to look after the show. Last but not least, Tangent Central here on MMO Reporter. There is a new Warcraft trailer that is now released. If you want to go and check that out, we'll give you a little bit of a preview here for you to check out. I saw something on Reddit that gave me hope, because I have yet to be impressed by any of the trailers for this particular movie. And it's not to do with any of the graphics or anything like that. I just don't think it looks super interesting. But someone said that watching, they saw the trailer. Apparently, it's on Batman versus Superman, and the visuals drew you in so much more on the big screen than they do on your home screen, on your computer screen. And maybe that will be the difference. Maybe I'll be drawn in when it's on the big screen, and I'll really like it. But as of right now, I want to see it, but I'm not super keen to see it. What about you?
I'm more interested in this than I am in Batman versus Superman.
Oh, really?
Hmm. True story.
Well, there you go.
To be fair, I'm treating them as totally different movies. I'm expecting this to be cheeseball and hokey, right, and that, and totally and total fan service, and that's okay with me.
Yeah.
Whereas I expect Batman versus Superman to kind of trend a little bit more towards the middle, to kind of carrying on the legacy of Batman and Superman, and without cheese factor, because Batman has already had all the cheese that it can possibly endure. Thank you, George Clooney.
Yeah. Bat nipples. Okay, so that is our show for this week. Bill, if people want to get a hold of us, how would they do that?
Well, there are a bunch of ways. First of all, they can head over to MMOReporter.com to check out the central hub of everything MMO Reporter. You can send us an email, MMO.reporter@gmail.com. You can visit us at Facebook, Facebook.com/MMOReporter. You can tweet at any of the MMO Reporters, even the in absentia MMO Reporters, either at MMO_reporter for Chris, at Harry Hall for Harry Hall, or at MMO Bill for yours truly. You can give us a call at 616-666-6778 to leave us a voicemail. We would love to hear you. We'd love to hear what you think of. We'd actually like to hear your direct comparison, the Warcraft movie versus Batman versus Superman.
Well,
I want to hear what you all think.
One's out now.
Well, only one's out now. Let's try to get the people who haven't seen either yet and tell us which ones are more excited.
Okay.
And actually, even better might be the people who have already seen Batman versus Superman and tell us how excited they are for Warcraft.
There you go. All right, Bill.
I was going to say a few more things here. You can visit us over at YouTube, youtube.com/MMOReporterNetwork. You can head over to Patreon, patreon.com/MMOReporter, if you're looking to throw a few pennies our way. Or if you're not a Patreon kind of person, head over to MMOReporter.com/support for other ways to help us keep those MMO Reporter bits flowing.
Absolutely. There we go. Now I haven't cut you off before you finished. I'm so sorry, Bill. I'm a horrible person.
I'll forgive you this time.
Thank you so much for forgiving me. I really appreciate it. But not as much as I appreciate everyone downloading and listening to the podcast. First, before I say that, though, thanks for recording, Bill. Good show.
Thank you, Chris. It
was fun. And thanks to all of you out there for listening to the show, watching the show, however you may consume it. Thank you very much. We hope that you enjoyed this show. We hope that you enjoy all the videos and all that sort of stuff that we put out and all the other shows on the MMO Reporter Network. But most importantly, we hope to see you in game.
Don't forget about your old shoe. Need to cherish each and every little character you've got, no matter what level they're at. Don't forget about your old shoe. Need to cherish each and every.
Thanks for watching the video, everybody. Don't forget to check out all the other podcasts at MMOReporter.com or by clicking on any of the links here. And please check out our Patreon campaign at patreon.com/MMOReporter. Thanks, everyone, and see you in game.